Hello, this is Laura LaFay, your host for The Less Traveled Path to True Purpose. Finding purpose can be confusing if you're looking at only the external circumstances of your life. If you expect the purpose is going to show up only as success, and you're wanting all the pieces to kind of fall neatly into place, sort of as a sign that you're on the right track, you may be missing the message of purpose. Our guest today watched her life fall apart before she pieced it back together in a whole new way. You'll meet her in just a moment, but I'd like to express my gratitude for all of my wonderful guests. I feel incredibly fortunate to be speaking with all of these extraordinary leaders. I know you'll find inspiration as well as practical information during this summit. You won't want to miss a single one, and I know I keep saying that, but it's because it's true. Before I introduce my remarkable guest today, let me just remind you that all of my guest experts have gifts for you. Not only will the gifts add value to you in your life, they'll also enable you to stay in touch with them. You'll find the gifts on the speaker page, and a link for that page is in all the emails that you'll receive during the summit. My guest today is Karen Eli. She's the founding director of the Sedona Women's Institute, with the mission of providing guidance, tools, and support for women seeking authentic lives of peace and meaning. She's the author of 5 books, Daring to Dream, Reflections on the Year I Found Myself, A Retreat of My Own, Breathing Space, Mini Retreats for the Heart and Soul, 21 Days of Gratitude, and 21 Stepping Stones to a Peaceful, More Meaningful Life. Her message couldn't be more aligned with our topic. Welcome, Karen.
Thank you for having me, Laura.
It's my pleasure. So I'd like to start out just asking you, what does finding purpose mean to you?
Well, it really means everything to me, you know, I mean, to this path. I'm listening to what you were just saying. I'm thinking of what a friend used to tell me, and that this path is not for sissies. You know, it's quite a journey. And finding purpose is really the upside of finding yourself. You know, of taking that journey to figure out, who am I really, besides the roles I play, besides the masks I wear? Is there some woman really in there? And that's what began my journey 28, almost 29 years ago, when I sort of woke up. And to me, this is all about really the Haraway's journey. I'm in the process of doing a whole month on that in one of the classes that I'm doing. And Haraway's journey was really brought to light primarily by Joseph Campbell. He called it the hero's journey, but I see no difference. A great mythologist, philosopher, teacher about, you know, the path that we all take when we get the call. You know, and we do this many times when we suddenly wake up and realize that we've got to take, you know, sort of the road less followed. Mm. You know, we've got to find ourselves, find our purpose. And when we set out on that, it is the road less followed, because it's not an easy path always. But the ultimate thing is you find yourself in the end, and there's no journey more worth taking, in my opinion.
So, how would somebody who's feeling that way, how would somebody begin?
Well, you know, there have been many, many, many books been written on this topic. Some very recent ones, Eat, Pray, Love, with the Heroine's Journey. Wild, by Cheryl Strayed, about walking the Pacific Crest Trail. And in both of those women's cases, they came to a point where they knew they couldn't do what they're doing any longer. That they literally were willing to just walk into the unknown rather than continue doing it. And I think that's when we step into that and begin to say, this may feel crazy, and our left brain is saying, this is nuts. You know, everyone's going to think you're crazy, and many of the people you know might, when we walk from jobs and everything known and relationships and, you know, and all the things that we often have to do to walk this journey, you know, to find ourselves, to find lives of meaning and passion and authenticity. And it really is, to me, the purpose of all of our lives. And I think it's really, not to get real metaphysical, but I do live in Sedona. I think it's really even more important for women to begin doing this in this time, for the feminine, you know, to step up in all of its forms and really just walk our own path, you know, honestly and real. And so really, it's what my business is all about, because when I got that call and started on this path, I just thought I was crazy. I knew you back then, Laura. I spent 5 years going from therapist to therapist because I thought I'd lost my mind. You know, this call, this wake-up, whatever we want to call it, that I was living the American dream. A husband who loved me, two beautiful children, a gorgeous house in the suburbs, and suddenly it wasn't working. And that just took me out of everything. Well, my daughters were grown by then, but it just took me out of everything. And it's not necessarily, it's not a path for sissies, because you got to be willing to walk. And I think we walk on that path when we finally get to the point where we can't do what we've been doing any longer. We can't go to this dead-end job any longer. We can't stay in a relationship that is not serving us, or maybe has never served us. You know, we can't stay in a place. We can't stay with people, with friends, with people that don't support this journey we're on. And I think that's an important piece, particularly for women. Because we're community-oriented, women are. We need each other, you know, to understand what we're doing. And it's one of the biggest joys of the work I do, and one of the things that I hear most consistently from women that come to my programs. It's like, wow, this is the first time I've been surrounded by other women asking these same questions. And we need that support, particularly when we start stepping outside of our comfort zone, you know, to not feel like we're crazy and we just need medication, to understand that, you know, that it is the heroine's journey to say, you know, enough. Enough of the old way. I'm going to walk my way. I'm going to find my answers. And, you know, I'm willing to do what it takes to do that. So it makes this work really important to us as individuals, and I really do believe for our communities, for our families, for our planet, that this begins, you know, to happen. You know, as the Dalai Lama said in a speech a couple of years ago, Western women are going to save the world. And I believe that to be true. If we start stepping up and saying enough, you know, of killing our sons and our brothers and our fathers, and enough of, you know, raping the earth. And that isn't all male or female. This isn't meant to be male bashing. But it's the feminine as opposed to the masculine. And so it makes this process, you know, really important to me. And I think the time is now. So that's really what my business is about. Because when I woke up at 40 and had these yearnings, I had no idea what it was about. By the time I finished going to a bunch of therapists and finally discovered this really was ultimately a spiritual journey, the journey back to me, and began on that, wow. I mean, it's taken me into places I didn't know possible. So, and it's an extraordinary journey. And you know, when you get on that, the heroine's or hero's journey, there's always places where you have to, you know, face the dragon, so to speak. You know, stand up even when you're terrified, and trust your own intuition, trust your own faith, you know, and continue to walk through that. And it's easy, you know, to turn around and run back to what we know. And often we do that many times before we finally walk. You know, it takes, you know, it's up to us to decide how miserable we want to be. I guess that's it. And then people start looking for other women, start looking for help in books. They find people like me on the internet. They find books that help them. And they find friends that support that journey. They find spiritual beliefs that support that, or spiritual practices. And so those are the things that sustain us, you know, on that journey. Is that making some sense?
It does make sense. And I think, you know, the question that I had asked you was, what might somebody do? And I think your answer seemed to be, you're probably already doing it, and maybe you don't know that. You know, maybe the fact that you're unhappy in your job, or maybe that you're questioning your relationship, or you're wanting to dive more deeply into that, those are the signs that you're actually ready to be moving towards something that's more meaningful. Is that what you're saying?
Exactly. Exactly. But I think the journey, the heroine's journey, is truly the one that steps onto that, even when they're afraid. Do I think most people do that? No, I think it's probably not in huge numbers, but I'm hoping, I'm doing my piece to assure that it's more numbers. You know, and I think it's important once you get on there to find some support. Whether you come to something like I do and many other women doing this work, or books or a community that helps you, it really I think it's really difficult to do this when you're really all alone. You need to find some support somewhere, other people that are asking the same questions and walking that same path. And then you don't feel crazy. And then you have people to check in with and people, you know, that are your cheerleaders and say, yeah, this is hard, but keep going. You know, and keep going back to yourself. Is this my path? Is this my path? You know, begin to ask yourself, not that left brain anxious piece of us, but that heart space. So.
Yes, thank you for differentiating that, because I think sometimes the question is the same, but it's where you're coming from with that question. Like you just said. Are you coming from the place of doubt, self-doubt, or are you coming from the place of, okay, I'm just checking in, which is more of a heart space?
Exactly. And I mean, I don't know if you've read The Untethered Soul, or some of your listeners have, by Michael Singer, but in his first chapter, he talks about, I've named mine Nigel because I think it's funny, but that left brain chatter that we listen to that we think is really us talking to us, when really it's that computer that is our brain that is trying to keep us safe, but it generally, you know, is not encouraging of these kind of paths. What if this doesn't go well? What if, you know, what if you give up your job and all these things? And so there are times like this you need to, you know, to ask that voice to please be quiet, because you need to hear another voice, which is that authentic voice, you know, which is really us, that internal wise woman that's inside us that really is trying to talk if we can silence the other conversation down and really listen to her.
Right.
And, you know, and sit quietly and really say, what is my path, though? Please, Nigel, for now, quit chattering. You're welcome to come along, because I know you're trying to keep me safe, but I can't listen to this anymore. And I need to walk my path, and this is what I'm going to do. And so, yeah, and that's something that we learn. And we can certainly, I don't think it's something intuitive, because most of us grow up thinking that that chatter in our brain is really us talking to us. And that is really a big eye-opener when you realize that we're really the listener, not the chatterer.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And so beginning to listen to the listener, which really is our inner wise woman connected, that all it is, whatever you call that, whatever your belief system is, that soul person that is us, that really always knows the way home, if we learn to listen to her. So quieting our world down, you know, is really the most important piece in this. Whatever you can find to do that, you know, whether it's doing your own retreats or coming to a retreat like I do and other people do, or, you know, it's beginning to do meditation, you know, beginning to take quiet walks in nature, just sitting, you know, just being enough so that you can hear the whispers of your own heart instead of Nigel chattering away. And it's actually quite entertaining to name him or her. Actually, sometimes I call it the committee, because that's really kind of what it is. It's like often a lot of it is every negative thing you've heard.
Right.
From your parents, from a first husband, from a boss, from a, you know, whatever it is, your community, your church, you know, that chatters the way that you're too old to do this, and that's foolish, and you ought to be saving your money, and, you know, I mean, whatever it is. Or you're a woman, that's not safe, you shouldn't be doing that. Yeah, and so I really think, because, you know, before the days of when I started this on this path 28 years ago, there was no internet. I had no way to find somebody like me, so I kind of had to chart my own thing, and I did it through books, which is why I have a big book list, you know, recommended reading list on my website. You know, if you haven't got anything else right now, begin reading really, really good books, like Michael Singer's The Untethered Soul. I mean, that's a real eye-opener, the first chapter.
Mm-hmm.
What if we are not the voice in our head? What if we're the listener? How does that change everything? I just love that.
Yes, yes, yeah. Absolutely. Do you think this is new? Do you think that there's an element of women searching that, what do you think? What do you think's going on? Why are so many women asking these questions at this point? Or do you think we always have?
No, I think there is a resurgence of this at this point. I mean, I think it's really dramatic, actually, what's going on, particularly with women, you know, beginning to sort of say no more the same thing. I mean, you know, we have something to share, too. And heaven knows, I think, you know, the world has been dominated by, you know, masculine thinking by men and women. for 3,000 plus years. And so, you know, who knows? I mean, I could get very esoteric about that. I don't know that I know or even have a guess, but I know it's happening. And I know it's being led by women. Men have their own way of dealing with things and making these kinds of changes in their life and changing the world. But, you know, women do it in our own way. And I think when you look at the tremendous numbers of women doing this kind of work, like what I do, coming to these kinds of things, reading these kind of books, you know, I mean, that's pretty much dominated by women. And, you know, I'm not quite sure where it comes from, but it's happening. You know, I mean, when the Dalai Lama said that, I thought, oh, it's not just what I'm seeing. We all know, you know, kind of what we see, and of course, that's my life. It's what I spend all day, every day doing, is working on these things and working with these kind of people. So you start thinking, am I seeing this just little microcosm of the world? But I don't believe that's true. Not if you look at who's buying these kind of books and coming to these kind of programs. It is primarily women. Or men with very strong feminine, you know, qualities, mm-hmm. That have a very strong feminine side to them, that are really looking for better ways to solve problems, you know, in the world, not only for their own lives, but so yeah, I agree with the Dalai Lama. I think the more we all stand up, the more we can really change everything. And I think women are all over the world. That's why we're seeing the huge backlashes, not only in this country, but certainly in, you know, in the Middle East and in Southeast Asia and Asia, I mean, really all over the world. And so it's interesting to watch. It's interesting times.
It is.
It's very interesting times.
So I just want to circle back for a minute and ask you, how did you wind up in Sedona?
I'm the only one I know that wasn't smart enough to move here on her own. really, I mean, everyone I know, I mean, there's always a story in a place like Sedona, because it's such a pilgrimage sort of spot. When I left my marriage, you know, it was almost 17 years ago now, I was doing a national search. I mean, I needed a job that actually really supported me. And that national search, I mean, I'd run nonprofits for 30 years. That brought me to a job in Flagstaff, running an no-kill animal shelter, which is a mission that I care about, but it really wasn't my life's work. And so, but, you know, it was good. It looked a lot like Colorado, which is still home to me. But I promised them 2 years, and 2 years to the day when I started that job was a job listing, an opening for the executive director of the Sedona Arts Center. So I applied and got that job, and that's what moved me here. So it felt like some sort of a divine thread pulling me down here. Mm-hmm. And I ended up here working like crazy at that job until I suddenly realized I'd been wanting to start a program like I do now for a long time. Then you suddenly find yourself at like ground zero for this kind of work. You know, I mean, if not in Sedona, where would I do this? Even though I don't do everything I do here, this is the place for this to happen, because Sedona is one of the places in the world that people come to for personal and spiritual renewal. And so, you know, it's a marvelous place to live and a marvelous place to do this kind of work. So, yeah, I wasn't smart enough to do it myself.
Well,
even when I got the job here, I'm thinking, I don't know if I like living there, you know, but absolutely I do. And so it's perfect for me and for this work. And people want to come here, particularly women.
And that's a perfect example of how we tell ourselves, oh, I wasn't smart enough to go there, but yet you did go there. And so clearly you were smart enough to go there.
Well, I'm at least smart enough to listen. I mean, I wanted the job. You know, I mean, the job was like so perfect. And when they interviewed me for the job, we did a phone interview once, and before I actually met them. And at the end of the interview, they asked me, and so why do you think that we should think about hiring you for this job? And I said, because I know it's just my job. So they teased me about that the whole time I worked there. I said, because I just knew it was. This was destiny. I was supposed to be down here and do that job. But, you know, I did that and a woman's way for 3 years before I began to do that full time. And a woman's way, which I started 12 years ago, became the Sedona Women's Institute in the last 4 months.
Mm-hmm.
So it's really an expansion on what I've been doing really for my whole life, but certainly full-time for the last 12 years.
That's wonderful.
So it's been a journey. It's part of the heroine's journey. You know, when you step into that, even when you don't know if it's the right thing, but you know it's the thing you should do.
Right.
That's what's then you walk into that.
So are there,
walk into it.
Are there any specific beliefs or mindset or kind of a shift that you think that sort of takes place that helps someone to kind of accept, okay, I'm on this path, I'm scared, I don't know what I'm supposed to do, but I'm okay. Is there a particular kind of a shift that can happen or a mindset that you would suggest or some way that you would offer a tip or advice about that moment where you go, okay, I'm going to accept that this is what's happening. This is where I'm going.
And that's an interesting question because people have asked me that before, and I don't know what it is, but when you feel it, you know it. To me, it's, and this may sound a little Sedona woo-woo, but it's an energy. I mean, you feel a shift that happens. Something has happened to say, you know, no more. I've been doing this till now, but now I'm not going to do that. I'm going to stay on this path. Because there's many times in that journey, in the heroine's journey, where it would be easy to, you know, to not go forward. You know, to go back to the home and the life and the secure job and the paychecks and, you know, whatever else you've had in the past that makes you feel safe. Another man besides your husband, another job like the other one, you know. Whatever it is that makes us feel safe in our world, but I think, you know, there's certainly a lot of, I think we make those changes when we get to the point where we're so uncomfortable. I mean, no one likes to make huge changes. It makes us nervous. It makes people we love nervous and people that love us nervous because they worry about us. But we make those changes when we know that we have no choice. You know, our life may not literally be in danger, but we feel from the inside it really is, you know? If I continue to do this, I mean, I know the day that I made the decision to leave my 32-year marriage, I just woke up Mother's Day morning, 5:30 in the morning in 1998, and just said no more, and I have no idea what happened in the middle of the night. No fight, no particular problems, but I just thought, I can see the end of my life from here. I was 51, and I know when I get to the end, this is not what I'm meant to do. It was till now, but it's not any longer. And I think that's where we get lost, because we take a job, you know, we study in school, we take a job that we love, we marry somebody we love, we start a life, you know, that we love maybe for a while, you know, we love being married, we love raising our children or whatever we've been doing or the career we've got, and I think that we mistake the comfort that we feel with that after a while for being what we need to do for our whole life. And a lot of the rules, especially from my generation, about what marriage means, you know, gets in the way of that too. Or even leaving a job, you know. A lot of us were raised by parents with the depression. You get a good job, you don't leave it. Mm-hmm. You're married to a good woman or a good man, you don't leave it. You know, you just, you know, hunker down and it's not perfect, but it'll do. But I think for many of us, you know, in my case anyway, it was just dumb. I enjoyed most of my marriage in my life, but then it just was done. And I think we kind of know that at some point, but that is where the journey begins. And we have a choice as to whether to accept that call and step onto that or to say no. And, of course, I think what people confuse that's interesting is we think that holding still is safe. And really there is no such thing. If you're not going forward, you really are going backwards. And, you know, when you hold still and stay in something that's not working, what follows is depression and really a slow decline, you know, in vibrancy and in health and all sorts of things because we're just, you know, like Thoreau so beautifully said, we're living lives of quiet desperation. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe nobody's beating anybody up. Maybe there's no horrible thing going on, but nobody is thriving within this marriage or within the job that you're currently in or the situation you're in. And so, you know, it's really an important journey to take for all of us. And more women are. You know, I mean, my emails that I go out to 5,000 women all over the world, and women all over the world are asking the same questions. You know, with some exceptions when people are just trying to survive. But women that have, you know, that are not just spending all the time trying to figure out how to eat and be safe, you know, they're asking those questions. I hear from women on almost every continent, you know, you know, who am I really, and what am I supposed to do with this life? And, you know, we're living so long. So if we spend our energy building a career or raising a family or maybe both, and we get to, you know, perimenopause and into menopause, and we start getting a little more testosterone, a little less estrogen, and we go, wait a minute, what about me? You know, I mean, what? Wait a minute. I've spent my whole life taking care of everyone else, and that's not bad. I mean, that's what we women do so beautifully. But, you know, I think it's, you know, the indigenous cultures call it walkabouts, and, you know, they have different names for it. You know, you get to a certain age, you're expected to go on a spiritual journey, to walk in the proverbial desert for 40 days and 40 nights, you know, find yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's normal about those ages for men and women. You know, because kind of we've been on remote control, you know. We grew up as kids. We got schooling. You know, we fell in love. We got married. We got a job. You know, we had children. Whatever we've been doing, we've sort of been on what feels to me like a people mover. Like they have at the airports, you know. We just get on and we go, and I say in a number of my books, I just follow my mother and grandmother's life, which was okay for a lot of time. And then it wasn't. And so, yeah. So, but all I can say to other women, you know, is nothing I've done in the last, you know, 20 years would have happened if I hadn't stepped onto that and continue to step onto it. Mm-hmm. The good and bad news is we don't do it once. You know, it keeps showing up.
It's like,
okay, like I'm kind of comfortable in this path now.
It's like one of those flat escalators. What do they call those flat escalators in the airports?
Yes, really. Yeah, really.
Like
yes.
There.
Yes. Uh-huh. And so, yeah, we like to be comfortable, you know. We don't make changes when we're that comfortable. So sometimes we need a real wake-up call. That's why women often step on this path when a divorce falls apart, whether it was their choice or not, when they have a huge financial setback, when they have a terrible health crisis, when they lose somebody.
Yeah.
God forbid one of their children or, you know, their husband or a parent. And they really begin to go, okay, I got to look at the bigger picture here. That's often what brings people onto this path.
Mm-hmm.
Because if we're comfortable, we don't do it.
Right. There's no reason to. We've got safe defined a certain way, and as long as that doesn't
change. Oh, yeah. Everyone likes to be comfortable, me included. Feels good. I'm coasting. This is nice. And so, you know, that's a different way to look at those huge bumps that we hit. Where suddenly all of your everything is questioned and everything is thrown into out there for discussion. It's like, wait a minute, I've become way too comfortable with this. And those are where, you know, the gifts are when everything falls apart. When we realize that that's where the gifts are. That's where we got the chance to sort of rise like the proverbial phoenix from the ashes, or lie down there and, you know, die. Not necessarily physically, but in other ways. But yeah, I mean, when we begin to see those big bumps, or even the little bumps as wake-up calls, to say it's time to make changes, then we're not quite so terrified by them either. Mm-hmm. You know, we quit being, and of course, the more we walk this path and it's worked out really well, the little more confidence we get, or the more time we spend in retreats like I offer and many other people offer, or in support communities where we get that, the more we realize that we're not alone on this. It'll be okay.
Yes.
It'll just take in a new way, you know. I mean, most of us haven't gone without too many meals. Most of us are on diet, so going without meals and a roof over our head is really not a problem. So, yeah, it's a fabulous journey. All I can say is it can be frightening at times, but the heroine's journey is, to me, what it's all about. It's the foundation of all this work. And when you really get that, if people haven't read Pray, Love, or Wild, you know, get it. Or Paulo Coelho's amazing book, The Alchemist, which is which is written in fable form. But, it's about that journey. And also things like Alice in Wonderland and The Wizard of Oz, you know, which are classics, you know, about, you know, how do you get home? How do you come back to yourself?
Yes.
You know, you buy the red shoes, which is, you know, for most women a good thing anyway. You buy the red shoes and you take the path. In these stories, that's why Joseph Campbell studied them so much, have been written in all cultures forever. This myth of, you know, the hero's journey, it's in so many movies. I mean, it just, it is the journey for everybody at some point or another.
Yes, it's a metaphor for life.
It is. It absolutely is. It's what we all get to do or not. So, it's a good one. I want to tell the listeners to this. It's been the best thing in my life, you know, to actually walk on that and not only find myself. You know, when I had an editor helping me with my first book, Daring to Dream, Reflections in the Air I Found Myself, she hated the title because she said, there's no point in time where you find yourself. I said, of course there is. We can't live there all the time because we easily do get lost. We all do, but of course there is. And it's fabulous when you actually come back to you and you know her, then you can live from there, you know, much more consistently. So it's worth doing. It's worth doing.
It's absolutely worth doing. Well, Karen, I want to thank you so much. It has been such a pleasure to speak with you today. I love the work that you're doing, and I love your story, and I love you. So I'm so happy to have this.
Thanks, Laura. And you know, you were a part of that journey, as you and I both know,
yes,
early on. And can I give the name of my business or website, or do you do that?
You can certainly you can do that, and I'm going to be doing that as well, but you just go right ahead.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, the name of my business is the Sedona Women's Institute. Website is Sedona, S-E-D-O-N-A, womensinstitute.com. You can see all sorts of things about the work we do, what it's about me, about order my books. You can also see programs that are coming up, connect with other women on this path. Got all sorts of ways to connect. So even if you don't have anyone that lives near you, there are fairly simple ways to begin connecting with women around the world that are asking the same questions. So I encourage your listeners to think about that. And there's many other people doing what I do too, I'm assuming, because you're interviewing 21 of them. So that's fabulous, Laura. Thank you so much for asking me to do this.
Absolutely.
I've been dealing with a flu, but I'm feeling better. Nothing like a good hour, 45-minute conversation on something I love. It fixes
right.
Everything, even the flu.
Well, thank you again, Karen. And thanks to all of you out there listening. Join us again very soon.